Welcome to Bible Study. I'm glad you're here tonight. I am Dr. Randy White, and we have been studying the book of Song of Solomon. And tonight we come into the fifth chapter, or pick up in the fifth chapter where we left off, having covered verse 1 last week. And we will just make our journey through chapter 5 tonight. We have been considering that the Song of Solomon is God's love song for Israel. And we have watched as God has drawn this bride, really Christ the King, the Messiah, has drawn his bride who wasn't sure of herself and also wasn't so sure of him. And tonight we're even going to see some of this. And I think it just has given a fabulous picture of of Israel in the last times, both the land of Israel and the people of Israel. And I think in a sense you have to take that collectively, because the people and the land are so much part of the same thing. And so we've got to put all that together. And we have this last days Israel that is torn, trying to decide, does she love herself? Does she love her her king who is wooing her and courting her and desiring her, and which way is she going to go? And that's the consideration, and we're going to see that even more tonight as we come into chapter 5 and make our journey. And after this session, we will have the session notes available for you at randywhiteministries.org. But we're going to start tonight in chapter 5, verse 2. And we're going to see the bride is talking in chapter 5, verse 2. The bride is talking. Now, I want to back up just a little bit to chapter 5, verse 1. And the groom is speaking. And really, chapter 5, verse 1 concludes chapter 4. And we're going to just draw a line, if it were, in chapter 5 after verse 1 and start over again in verse 2. So it says in verse 1, I'm coming to my garden, my sister, my spouse. I've gathered my myrrh with my spice. I've eaten my honeycomb with my honey. I've drunk my wine with my milk. Eat, O friends, drink, yea, drink abundantly, O beloved. It is a very happy conclusion to chapter 4. You could even call chapter 4 the marriage, so to speak. And so then you might wonder, when we get into chapter 5, verse 2, all of a sudden, as we're going to see in a moment, there's going to be a separation. Now, as I mentioned before, this is a pattern that we see in Song of Solomon. And the pattern is that we start out with the relationship not intact, but the desire of one of the other parties is there, and they're moving toward that, and they edge toward that, and sometimes they even get to that relationship, and then there's a line drawn, and we back up and start over again. So it's this pattern, this almost cycle that goes. It really, I think, is a new way of saying the same thing. It is a way of showing us, I think, that Israel is going to struggle in its return to come to her king. That it's not just going to be a smooth and instantaneous kind of thing that happens. It is going to be through the day of Jacob's trouble that Israel is going to finally, almost even reluctantly, come to her king. Now, this is, should be no surprise to us, because if you've ever read the Hebrew scriptures that we typically call the Old Testament, you know this is the Israel, the Hebrew pattern, isn't it? To come up to God, to move away from Him. To come to Him, to move away from Him. To come to Him, to move away from Him. And we're seeing this, I think, also in the Song of Solomon. And so we're going to start the story, or the cycle, over again here just a little bit in this particular chapter. So the bride is speaking in verse 2. And the bride says, I sleep, but my heart waketh. It's the voice of my beloved that knocketh, saying, open to me, my sister, my love, my dove, my undefiled, for my head is filled with dew and my locks with drops from the night. Now, As you consider this particular matter here, I think that we see a couple of things that are really very important as this cycle begins. So here we have the bride who sleepeth. And in this cycle of storytelling, again, the author goes back to the beginning of the relationship, and the bride is asleep, but her heart waketh at the voice of her beloved that knocketh. Now, my heart waketh. My heart wakes up. I'm asleep, but my heart wakes up. Some of you, I think, have been in that kind of situation before, for good or for bad. Maybe it's, you know, you're a child, and it's a day before Christmas, you know, and you might go to sleep, but man, your heart is awake. And this is kind of the situation that she is in. Here, let's just make this take out the feeling here. And she says, "Boy, you know, my heart woke up. I was deep in sleep, but my heart woke up and said, hey, it's the voice of my beloved." So you see here, they are separated. They're not together, because the voice of my beloved knocks. Now, that's kind of odd for a voice to knock, but it is used obviously somewhat symbolically that her king once again is calling her. The voice of my beloved knocketh. You know, I think this is somewhat reflected in Revelation chapter 3, verse 20, which is, of course, in the letter to the seven churches, and I believe is written to the last day's remnant. And do you remember that in Revelation chapter 3, verse 20, very familiar verse, of course, it says what? "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone would open up the door, I would come in and sup with him, and he with me." You know, we use that often in an evangelistic sense, and I'm not sure it's totally unfounded there. But I think that really it is a message to the last day's church. In fact, I think I just want to go there and show you something here as we go, and it's Revelation chapter 5, verse 2. Verse 20 is what that should be. Revelation chapter 5, verse 20. Well, I'm going to find it here in a moment. It's Revelation chapter 3, verse 20. How about that? That'll show you to go on memory. "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in and will sup with him, and he with me." Now, a couple of things about this. Again, we use it evangelistically, and it's not completely unfounded there, but I'm not sure that's the direct application of it either. First of all, this "I will come in and sup with him and he with me," that is really, I think, in a sense, that is a word of banqueting. And the banqueting picture is this picture of the coming kingdom. So he's saying, hey, you want into the kingdom, come in here. Now, here's another reason I say this. The very next verse, "To him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame and sat down with my Father in his throne." Now, this doesn't belong really in the age of grace. First of all, overcoming is something you do on your own. And then it comes, you know, here to come and sit with him in the throne. These are kingdom kind of things that come along that I think that we have to look at and have to consider. So, considering that then, as we come through here, let me get this back here to Song of Solomon, chapter 5, verse 2. "The voice of my beloved knocketh. Behold, I stand at the door and knock." Here in the last days, she's asleep, but her heart wakes up. And I think that's a description of the way it's going to be for Israel. She's asleep, but her heart hears his voice. I think there's even, by the way, indication. I could give a number of illustrations of this, but I won't. I think there's indication that Israel, that is asleep today, asleep spiritually today, is starting to hear his voice and starting to wake up. So, here's his voice that says, "Open to me, my sister, my love, my dove, my undefiled, For my head is filled with dew, and my locks with the drops of the night. It's an odd introduction, isn't it, here, when he says, my head is filled with dew, and my locks. This term right here is only used twice in the scripture, and both times in this chapter here. And it is a word that does not, this proves that I am not the Messiah, because it is a word that has to do with hair. And it's the flowing hair, my locks, with drops of dew. Now, what in the world is going on here to say my head is filled with dew, my hair with drops of the night? I think, again, that this is one of these things that is, I think you could say, meaningless at best, awkward, as far as I'll go with it, awkward at worst, when you try to take the Song of Solomon and don't realize that it's talking about something else. And there are so many who take these passages, again, and they make them to be about sex, and they come up with all sorts of wild stuff in here, which we'll see even more as we get down here to verse 4. And it's just almost pornographic what you read about what is happening here. And then it boggles the mind, because you say, wait a minute, isn't this king representative of Christ or of the Messiah? And I believe that he is. Now, some don't believe that. They say, no, this is just King Solomon. This is just a love story here. And I have a hard time buying that, because I think that all scripture is profitable for doctrine, correction, training in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfectly equipped, adequate for every good work. And so this has got to be more than just a sex manual here. And I've said that many times throughout this series. So here he comes and he says, my head filled with dew, my locks with drops of the night. Now, in chapter 4, he described the bride. We looked at it last week. And he described the bride really in terms of the land. We talked last week about Beulah land, about married land. And he described the land of Israel, which is so much a part of who Israel is, and how that land is going to be married in the city of, the New Jerusalem, or that is the bride of Christ. And that was the description. He described her physically in terms of land. And what does the land, especially the millennial land or the Garden of Eden land, what was it, I'll use the word, nourished with? It was nourished with the dew, wasn't it, in the Garden of Eden. And here he comes again, keeping this picture, speaking to the bride who is the Beulah land and saying, hey, guess what I've brought to you? I've been gone, but now I am bringing the dew. My head is filled with dew, my locks with drops of the night. Now, here she's been sleeping, so she's, let's assume this is talking about the Beulah land, the married land. The land has been forsaken, as Isaiah says, but it's no longer going to be called forsaken. Now it's going to be called Beulah. And that land has been forsaken. And what does forsaken land need? It needs water, really. I happen to live in the desert, and I know that you go out and the land can just be desolate. And then you'll find where there's water and the land is beautiful and unbelievably fruitful. In fact, I haven't done any kind of study on this, but I'm almost convinced that there's no more fruitful land than desert land if you can just get water on it. It will pour forth abundant fruits and vegetables and crops and just unbelievable if you get water on it. Here he comes and says, lady, you've been forsaken, but I'm bringing you some water. I am going to bless you with the dew of the morning, a Garden of Eden kind of picture. Now, as we carry on there, in verse 3, it says, I've put off my coat. Now, this is the woman who's speaking again here. So she really is speaking all the way through. She starts here, I sleep, but my heart waketh. And I heard the voice. And here she quotes the king. This is what I heard the king say. But she's continuing to talk. And she continues to talk then in verse 3. And she says, I've put off my coat. How shall I put it on? I've washed my feet. How shall I defile them? Now, it's a little bit difficult to interpret this verse, but here's what I think. I think that the bride here is showing reluctance. Again, look at it. She says, I've been sleeping. My heart hears you, but man, I just want to roll back over and go to bed. My heart's telling me, get up and go answer the door. But my body says, I've already put off my coat. How do I put it on? I've already washed my feet. How shall I defile them? You remember, in fact, let's look at just a couple of illustrations here. Let's consider, first of all, the book of Revelation, chapter 16 and verse 15. Here, the scripture says, behold, I come as a thief. Blessed is he that watcheth and keepeth his garments, lest he walk naked and they see his shame. It's an interesting little verse here, but here the woman comes up and says, I've already taken my coat off. How am I going to put it on? Let's consider another one that is related, perhaps even very clearly so. And this is in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 11. We'll just do verse 7. I almost need to pick up a few other verses here that says, you know, which of you, if he has a friend, goes at midnight and says to his friend, lend me 3 loaves, for a friend of mine is on his journey to come see me. I have nothing to set before him. Verse 7, and he from within shall answer and say, trouble me not. The door is now shut. My children are in bed. I cannot rise to aid thee. Now, here she comes in verse 3 and says, I'm already in bed. I hear your voice, but I'm already in bed. This reluctance, I know it makes you feel a little uncomfortable here because you last week thought, oh, we got such a beautiful love story. This is Hallmark. But now all of a sudden it's falling apart again and we're starting over. And here is her beloved shouting from the outside. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. I'll come in and dine with you. And she says, I put off my coat. How in the world can I get up and get dressed at this night? I washed my feet. How shall I defile them or get them dirty again? This is the way at least I interpret it. Now verse 4 says, my beloved put his hand by the hole of the door, and my bowels were moved for him. Now, once again, this is a verse that I think has been made almost pornographic by some interpreters, and I don't think there's any need to do so at all. But as you get into verse 4 here, this verse that is carried out almost again in this exclusively sexual sense is one that you need to allow Scripture to interpret Scripture. This one, I think, is a fascinating study of just how to study the Bible, this one verse right here. And so what I'm about to show you, I think, you can take and say, I can use this anytime I come upon a passage of Scripture that I just look at and say, what in the world is going on there? And there are these verses. You don't know if they're good, and you don't know if they're bad. And you look here, and the way it's translated, my beloved put his hand by the hole of the door, and my bowels were moved for him. Well, you can surmise. If you've already had an assumption, what do we do here? Question the assumptions. If you've already had the assumption that this is a sexual relationship between the man and the woman, the husband and the wife, then you'd go here with a sexual idea to it, and all of this would look, in a sense anyway, we'll say, would look very positive. But here's what I want to show you. You take this this information right here. My beloved put his hand by the hole, and then you remember, you notice here that the door here is inserted. It's italics. That means it's not there in the Hebrew. So he put his hand by the hole. Now, what in the world does this mean? Well, here I think is the best way to do this. I'm going to show you how to do it in the Logos software, which some of you will have and some of you do not have, but let me bring this up to size here just a little bit. And using, as I've mentioned before, using Hebrew interlinear is a little more challenging than Greek interlinear because of the backward nature of it, for one. But here it says, my beloved he thrust his hand into the opening. And it says, my inmost or my bowels were turbulent for him. Okay, that's a very literal rendering. Now, what I like to do in the Hebrew is take a phrase, because in the Hebrew, one word can often be translated many ways. And so in Greek, we can just do a single word search. In Hebrew, it's almost better to do a phrase search. And so I want to take this phrase right here that he thrust his hand. And I'm just going to highlight it here. Now, I would say for those of you who use Logos, by the way, when you highlight this here, if you've set these links, you notice this says an A and this says an A, and that's why when I scroll on one, it automatically scrolls on the other. If you do that, there's an underlying common text here, as there is here, when you highlight one, it automatically highlights the other, which is very helpful to come and when you're trying to do this Hebrew and say, okay, where do I come and get this? Now, here's what I'm going to do. Once I've highlighted that, I'm going to right-click, and there's the phrase just in Hebrew. That's the selection that we've got right here. And I'm just going to go down here and click this resource. And we're going to see every time this phrase that's translated, put in his hand, every time it comes in the Bible. And when I do that, it brings up this list right here. Now, the problem is you can't read that list, can you? Because it is in Hebrew. But you can click on each one of these. And in fact, you can even arrange it a little different where it will put the English up for you. But you can just click on these. There's eight times here. You can go through and you can do a little study. Now, I'm going to close out this particular window of this search, and that was the background to what I'm about to show you here on how I got there. So, my beloved put in his hand by the hole in the door. I want Scripture to interpret Scripture. I can come up with a wild imagination about what this means, and it could be a vivid imagination, but let the Scripture interpret itself. So what does put in his hand, that little phrase of two Hebrew words, what does that really mean? Well, I pull up those eight verses in which that phrase is used, and I want to just go through and show you a few of these things here. So let's look, for example, in Exodus. Let me get to the right screen, and we'll do that. Excuse me just a moment here. Got too many screens going on. And now we're going to look in Exodus chapter 22 and verse 7. And here, from that search I did just a moment ago, would have led us here, says, if a man shall deliver unto his neighbor money or stuff to keep, and it be stolen out of the man's house, if the thief be found, let him pay double. Now, in this particular phrase here, what we would find is that actually right here, stolen out of his house. And in fact, in that same passage, let's go down to verse 10. Let's see, where is it? I've already closed my search window and I didn't have all these down. The phrase here, I am just going to open that up so I make sure I give you the right phrase. So we're in verse 4. I'm going to do this one more time. He thrust his hand and, oops. He thrust his hand. I'm going to right click that, highlight that, click this resource. And here we go. Yeah, Exodus chapter 22, verse 7. Now, reason I want to do that is because now that I have this open, it will be highlighted here, and I can do this right here. verse 8. Okay, this is the, this is what, I know where I went wrong here now. You notice this says Exodus 22, verse 7, but here we're in Exodus chapter 22, verse 8. There are times when the Hebrew text has a different numbering than the English text. So when you write down your references, as I did, you got to make sure you get them right. So, verse 7 was about thievery, and it says, "If the thief be not found, then the master of the house shall be brought unto the judges to see whether he have put his hand into his neighbor's goods." Now, all you need to know is this is an issue about thievery. Put his hand means to reach in and steal. Okay, we can look from there, and we could go to chapter 22, and in the Greek, in the Hebrew text at least, it's verse 10, but it's in verse 11 over here. I'm going to highlight it once more so that you will be able to see it. And there it is right here for us. The Lord, then shall an oath of the Lord be between them both, that he that not put his hand into his neighbor's goods, and the owner of it, shall accept thereof, and he shall not make it good. It's all in the same chapter, and it's all about stealing. So there are those who put their hand, and that was a bad thing. Those who do not put their hand, that's a good thing. Now, again, in Song of Solomon, he puts his hand. We're trying to figure out what in the world does that mean. We can go, for example, to Exodus chapter 24 and verse 11. And it tells us, let's see right here, that he sent his hand. Let me get to the King James. Sorry about that. Chapter 24, verse 11, "And upon the nobles of the children of Israel he laid not his hand, and also they saw God and did eat and drink." Now here in Exodus 24, verse 11, it is used to lay his hand was used as an expression of punishment. Now here he did not lay his hand, and that was good. Now are you catching a pattern? In Exodus chapter 7, in Exodus chapter 22, the one who laid his hand, that was a bad thing. Here, it was a good thing that he did not lay his hand. We ought to be beginning to pick up that there's something negative about this laying on of hands, if I can misuse a term there. Let's go to Job chapter 28 and verse 9. And here we see the same little phrase that is used right here, and it's speaking of God, and it says, "He putteth forth his hand upon the rock. He overturneth the mountains by the roots." Now, here he's speaking of God in his creative power, his awesome creative power, and it says, "He putteth forth his hand upon the rock." But this is not just to lay your hand upon the rock. This is to overturn, put your hand on the rock and overturn it. I happen to live, of course, in the Rocky Mountains, and as I drive through the beauty of the Rocky Mountains, there are places that I look at, some of them every day, and I just look at that and I say, what awesome power created this. It is many places in the Rocky Mountains, it is a picture of sheer violence that took place. And this is kind of a picture of that, where you know, we live in a place where we have some overturned mountains. They were overturned by the roots, and so it's a negative thing to put his hand forth. Again, it's the exact same two Hebrew words, same format and everything in all of these that we are looking at. Then I can look at, here's the one in Song of Solomon, but let's jump forward to Esther chapter 8 and verse 7. And once again, we've got our words right here. And this is, I've taught on this just actually last night. We'll start in the middle. "Behold, I've given Esther the house of Haman, and him they have hanged upon the gallows, because he laid his hand on the Jews." Now, are you, seeing it here? To lay the hand on, this was a bad thing. This is a robbery and a punishment. Let's again look at the one final one other than the one that we had in Song of Solomon. And this is in 1 Chronicles chapter 13 and verse 10. And it says, "The anger of the Lord was kindled against Uzzah, and he smote him because he put his hand to the ark, and there he died before God." Now, what I want you to notice here is that we've got eight times, and seven of those times, not counting Song of Solomon, seven of those times, we can clearly see that to put forth the hand was not a positive thing. And we come to this one right here, Song of Solomon chapter 5, verse 4. And as we come into Song of Solomon chapter 5, verse 4, we're trying to figure out, is it a good thing or a bad thing that he put his hand by the hole? And I just want to say, you got to go by this principle here and say, let the Bible interpret itself. And if you're going to say putting his hand there is a positive and a delightful thing, you're going to have some really good splaining, right? How do you in the world do you explain that this is in the Bible something that is exclusively negative, but now this one time is very positive? Again, I don't think these two things go together. So I think we have to come and say, this is going to be a negative thing. So he puts his hand, if you will, it says he puts his hand by the hole. By the hole, literally, and of the door is something that King James has put in. Now, I have done the same thing on that little search there, and I want to look at just a couple of these passages here that by the whole is used two other times in Scripture, and one of them is 2 Kings chapter 10, verse 12, if I... have the verse 12 or 13, I'm sure it's going to be. And I'm going to find it here in just a moment. I might have to go back here and do that search again. I tell you what, I'm going to give I'm going to tell you what it says. It speaks of this collection, this offering that was taken, and the instruction was given to take this chest, and in this chest to literally just to put a hole in the top where they can put their offering in. It's an offering box, basically. Very simple term of just the hole here. And the other one, again, my challenge in finding that is the difference in verse numbering between Hebrew and English. But Ezekiel chapter 8, verse 7, we will try this out. Here we got this one. It says, "He brought me to the door of the court, and when I looked, behold, a hole in the wall." Okay, that's pretty simple, isn't it? We got one where it's a hole in the top of a box and another where it's a hole in the wall. It's just a hole is what it is. Here he starts chipping in this hole and he ends up making him a door. You know, here's a starting place where I can start chipping away. I also live in the area in which we have adobe buildings. And in adobe buildings, you know, and you want a window, or find some place to start chipping away. Or you want to find a door, you know, find if you can get a starting place, you can just start working your way in there and eventually cut out a window or cut out a door. And this is the same kind of picture that was given here, and really the same kind of construction that was given. So, my beloved put his hand by the hole. Now, they have inserted of the door, and I think they're right here. What it's saying, this is not anything sexual, what it's saying is, "I was asleep," she's saying, "my heart heard his voice, hey, my beloved, wake up." She says, "I'm asleep." And he's out there and he says, "I'm not going to take this." And he puts his hand, always use negative, he puts his hand by the hole. Basically, this what this is he's going to break in. And And she then says, my bowels were moved for him. Now, bowels is just the term for innards. Young's literal says the same thing. Bowels were removed for him. But let's look at the New American Standard and see what they have done with this particular verse. One reason I don't use the New American Standard anymore, as it comes and says, my beloved extended his hand through the opening, and my feelings were aroused for him. Now, that all looks very positive, and yet I am convinced that it doesn't mean my feelings were moved for him. Well, I think what it means is she's saying, oh my goodness, my heart was awake, but now my stomach is churning. He is coming in the door. And she begins to have really this great fear. So let's just look at it. In fact, doing the same thing, searching this phrase for were moved. And by the way, the only way to know what phrase to search is trial and error. Take a hunch and go at it and search through the scriptures and see what you find out. But these bowels again were moved. Let me try to show you a couple of scriptures like Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 20. Hopefully we'll be correct right here. Yes, we are. And here the Lord is speaking. He says, is Ephraim my dear son? Is he a pleasant child? For since I spake against him, I do earnestly remember him. That is, I've got some punishment on him. And as I've been punishing him, I earnestly remember him. Therefore, my bowels are troubled. We've got the same thing. Bowels are moved. Bowels are troubled. Now, again, considering what the New American Standard says over here. Well, we've switched passages. But as you know, the New American Standard in Song of Solomon says, my feelings were aroused. Here, bowels were troubled, bowels were moved. It is the same phrase. And she's not saying, oh, my heart was just fluttering with love. No, she's saying, oh, no, he's coming in. And we can look at another couple of phrases. I'll just show you one more. And that would be in the book of Psalms, chapter 46, verse 6. And here it says, the heathen raged and the kingdoms were moved. He uttered his voice and the earth melted. Now, we're actually looking for this phrase that was translated moved in Song of Solomon, chapter 5, verse 4. And yet it's not this moved right here. It's actually this one right here. The heathen raged. That raged is the same word talking about her bowels in chapter 5, verse 4. Her bowels raged. And this is not, again, a heart-fluttering kind of love experience. This is a oh-no kind of experience. So coming back to our passage here, chapter 5, verse 4, my beloved put his hand by the hole of the door, and my bowels were moved for him. Now, what I think I see right here is that though we kind of wanted to make this very positive, and she's saying, oh, I'm in love, and I hear him at the door, and when I heard him, you know, I invited him in, and he came in, we had this ecstatic experience. But that, I just think we have to do eisegesis for that. That is reading into instead of reading out of. This really, if we're going to say, I need to let the Bible be its own dictionary, then put the hand, it's always a bad thing. The hole, it's literally a hole that you could use to get a start through something. My bowels were moved, same word is raged. And my bowels were raged. They were upset for him all along the way. So I think here what we've got in this particular passage is that all three of these phrases, put in his hand, the whole, and the bowels removed, these three phrases are used really, especially the first and the last, they're used exclusively in a negative sense. And because they're used exclusively in a negative sense, I think we have to take this as negative. Now, let me back up again. And remind you what I said in verse 3. I've put off my coat, how shall I put it on? I've washed my feet, how shall I defile it? She's saying, I'm not getting up for you. And in that light, doesn't verse 4 make sense? That there's in verse 3 this lack of readiness of the bride. And this verse here then seems to be really words of disapproval, words of tribulation, if you will. And here's Israel, last days Israel, who comes and is asleep. Their heart starts to call. They begin to hear the knocking of the master, but they say, nah, I'm asleep. Don't bother me. Go away. And he then says, here's a little door. I'm going to begin to chip away at this little door. And it says, ultimately, I'm coming back. I am coming in there. I am going, you and I, you know, I don't know where the phrase comes, but it basically says, we're going to have a come to Jesus meeting. And this, I think, is the meaning of verse 4. Now, in verse 5, then, it comes along, almost a different picture, says, I rose up and opened to my beloved. Catch that. When he starts knocking away and saying, I am breaking in, now she gets up. And say, well, that's not really real. I mean, she's just doing it because she's trying to act good now because he's going to get her. And yet, what happens prophetically in the future? The church is taken out of here, and God begins to deal with sleeping Israel. And sleeping Israel, not interested. So much not interested, they'll follow another. They'll follow the Antichrist. And yet he begins to put his hand in. He begins to tear out that hole. It is called the day of Jacob's trouble or the tribulation. And it is through the tribulation, when her bowels are moved within her, that she then says, I rose up to my beloved. I've got a different tune now. I'm not saying, oh, I'm already asleep. I rose up to my beloved. It says, my hands dropped with myrrh and my fingers with sweet smelling myrrh. Now, myrrh is, as I mentioned last week, myrrh is always given in a positive light in the Old Testament. I think we have to take it in the positive light here. So she gets up and she says, I made myself ready real quick. You know, I went to the myrrh and I splashed it on and I put it on all over me so fast that my fingers were dripping with the stuff as I put my handles upon the lock. Now, you see what she's saying? She's saying, you don't have to break in. I will open the door. And in this beautiful way, we're going to see once again this cycle take place in the Song of Solomon. And so she says, I opened to my beloved. Again, no need to take this sexual. What she's saying is, he was knocking at the door. I wasn't going to get up until he started, breaking the door down. In that time of tribulation and stress, I came to my senses. I woke up. I got all fixed up with myrrh, and I opened, with my fingers dripping with myrrh, I opened up to my beloved. But my beloved had withdrawn himself and was gone. Now, isn't that interesting? I think what we have to do here is back up just a little bit and say, now wait a minute. What we may have here is not so much the tribulation, but this, you know, coming in that hole, maybe that's really talking more about the first coming. And the raging bowels or spirit of Israel in that first coming, and then through all of that, so maybe verse verse 4 describes, really in a sense, describes the first coming and all the way up to the second coming. A long period of time here. And then in the end, when she does rise up to her beloved, now she's ready. Or maybe you even say that this is the time when she opens the door. Maybe this is all the way back in the first century, you could even put it, and say, you know what? Here she comes about 70 AD and says, okay, I guess I better answer to him. And yet he's gone. He's not there. Where is my beloved? He was knocking a minute ago. I heard his voice a minute ago. And when she does get up, he's gone. And he had withdrawn himself. She says, you know, Israel really did have the opportunity at Pentecost. And it was at Pentecost that her beloved came knocking. And at Pentecost, in the power of the Holy Spirit, her beloved desired to come in, and yet she wasn't interested. She said, I'm going back to sleep. Roll over, go away. I'm not going to get up. And then she experienced the judgment of God in verse 4. And now in 5 and 6, she looks for him, but his presence isn't evident. Kind of like the book of Esther that we've been studying on Wednesday night. He seems to be gone, even though he can't be completely, because I will never leave you nor forsake you, remember he said? But just like in the book of Esther, he's gone undercover. He's not working out there in the open. So she says, I look for him. And then she says that he had withdrawn. The word withdrawn literally just means to go about. He had withdrawn. He had gone about. He was off taking care of someone else's business or some other business. He was not there at the door anymore. And here it says, my soul failed when he spake. Now, the issue here, my soul failed when he spake. If you notice in the Young's Literal, it just says, my soul went forth. And failed is a little bit of an interpretation, I think an accurate interpretation, but it is a little bit of an interpretation that the Hebrew word again just means to go forth. My soul went forth. And yet, with the context of these words, she's going back and she's saying, you know what? When he was there at the door speaking, his voice knocking, my soul failed. My soul just utterly failed. It did not get up out of its slumber in order to open the door for my beloved. And she says, now, look at this mess. Now he's gone. Where is he? Looking for him. So she does, as she's done before in verse 7, the watchmen that went about the city found me. They smote me. They wounded me. The keepers of the walls, they took away my veil from me. The identity of these watchmen that went about the city, their identity is not revealed. But they're negative. It's the second time we've seen them. I think that you have to say in some way these are the world leaders, I would say, of the age of the Gentiles. So here she is, the age of the Gentiles. Her master's gone. He's gone about. And she's going to begin looking for him. And the watchers of the city of Jerusalem, here we see, this is the age of the Gentiles, I think. And who is it that controls Jerusalem? I can promise you it is not the Jews. It's not the Israelis. We like to think they are sometimes since 1967 when the Jews had somewhat of a possession of Jerusalem. But just go ask the State Department what country Jerusalem is in. I promise you, you won't find anyone at the State Department or the U.S. government that will say Jerusalem is a city in Israel. They will not say it. They will foam at the mouth. They'll roll over and play dead. They will run and hide. You talk Jerusalem, they'll talk China. Whatever it is, they're not going to say it. because they will not admit, and there's not a government in the world really that will admit, that Jerusalem belongs to the Jews in Israel. And so the watchmen that went about the city, this is the, I think, again, the Gentile leaders. They found me, they smote me, they wounded me. That's a story of Israel down through the Jewish people down through the ages of the Gentiles, isn't it? And will be again there in the future. The keepers of the wall took my veil from me. And, you know, these watchmen, these keepers, by the way, the keepers and the watchmen, that's actually in Hebrew, it's the exact same word. The watchmen of the keepers, the watchmen of the keepers of the wall. Now, to close out here in verse 8, and we'll stop here. She says, I charge you, O daughters of Jerusalem. This is one of those that I encouraged you last week. This would be a great study to look at the daughters of Jerusalem, and I'll get it done here before our series is out. Who are the daughters of Jerusalem? The king speaks to the daughters of Jerusalem. The bride speaks to the daughters of Jerusalem. I charge you, O daughters of Jerusalem, if ye find my beloved, that ye tell him that I am sick of love. That is, I am love sick. You tell him my heart longs for him. And this is the point that the bride has come to. And let me go ahead and just do one more verse here, verse 9. Who knows? Maybe I'll do two more verses. We'll see. I just hate to stop. In verse 9, the maidens answer back, or the daughters of Jerusalem answer back, and they say, what is thy beloved more than another beloved? O thou fairest among women, what is thy beloved more than another beloved that thou dost so charge us? It really saying, you know, go out and find someone else. He's gone. And the daughters of Jerusalem are encouraging this. But look at her love as she comes in and says in verse 10, my beloved is white and ruddy, the chiefest among 10,000. She begins to describe him. And as she begins to describe him, she says a couple of these interesting things here, describing the king. And describes him really in great royalty, as she says he is white and ruddy. Now, I am convinced that white is not, Randy White says, white is not a good translation of this word. As a matter of fact, it would be a contradiction, because the word ruddy literally means, it's sometimes in modern translations translated handsome, but that's not really what it means. The word ruddy means red, or reddish brown. So how can you be white and red? Sort of reminds you of the old joke, you know, what's white and red, white and black and red all over, right? But here, white and ruddy. White's not really the best word, as you see here in the Young's Literal. It says clear and ruddy. The word translated white actually means dazzling. Strong says dazzling or glowing or bright or clear. So, my beloved is dazzling reddish brown, and he is the chiefest among 10,000. The chiefest what? This is a particular word for chiefest. If you follow that through doing a little word study, you'll see that it is used a number of places in the Song of Solomon in chapter 6. It's used twice, as a matter of fact, and it's used as the banner or the flag. So, really what it's saying is, hey, he is the strongest king that's out there. He's the strongest army that's out there. His banner, and remember later, she's going to say, his banner over me is love. His banner is stronger than any of the others. She's recognizing who he is. And then she begins to describe him. And because I'm not going to go into a lot of detail on this, I am just going to go ahead and complete this out tonight. She says, his head is as the most fine gold. His locks are bushy and black as a raven. That is his hair. His eyes are as the eyes of a dove by rivers of waters, washed with milk and fitly set. His cheeks are as bed of spices, as sweet flowers. His lips are like lilies dropping sweet-smelling myrrh. His hands are as gold rings set with beryl. His belly is a bright ivory overlaid with sapphires. His legs are as pillars of marble set upon the sockets of fine gold. His countenance is as the of Lebanon, excellent as the cedars. His mouth is most sweet, yea, he is altogether lovely. This is my beloved. This is my friend, O daughters of Jerusalem. That is her answer to those daughters of Jerusalem who say, what's he among all the others? You know, there's a lot of fish in the pond, is what they're telling her. And she says, no. Mine stands above all else. And she begins to describe him. And the picture is of a woman describing a king, the bride describing the royalty. You know, when you had the king describing the bride, I think you would agree with me, it wasn't quite as flattering as the king describing, the bride describing the king. She describes him in precious metals and jewels and beauty, and he describes her in terms of sheep and goats and agricultural and land kind of things. I think because he's describing Israel, which is part and parcel package of the land and the people, he describes his bride, and she describes the person of Jesus Christ in his brightness and in his royalty. And in many ways, the description that's given here could be given of, for example, the description you see of Jesus Christ when John sees him in the Revelation. And this beautiful picture is given right here. Well, perhaps you have a question. I'd love to have you put those in the question box or comment along the way, and we can take a look at those in just a moment. We may have a few who obviously need to be dismissed at this time, and you're welcome to do so next week, because next week is Thanksgiving in the United States, and so we'll be off a week, and then we'll pick up, and we will pick up in chapter 6 and begin to continue our way through this fabulous love story, this love story which is the Song of Solomon, God's love song for Israel. I am always delighted to have you join us on Thursday night for Bible study, and would be just thrilled to answer any questions or comments that you might have tonight. And as always, again, you can find us on the web, and we are at randywhiteministries.org, and there's some sermons under resources and under live broadcasts, and there's some courses you can take, and we may or may not have any room in our Holy Land tour. It's just about filled up, and we leave in a few weeks, of course we appreciate those of you who give donations, our Club 8 Club 360 members, and that is helpful. And once again, if you missed it at the beginning of the broadcast, at dispensationalpublishing.com/shop, you'll see the things we've got for sale, and there's some on sale resources, and there's some free shipping resources right there, and all of the other things that we've got on there, and would love to meet you and see you online at either one of those places. And of course, my email is randy@randywhiteministries.org. Well, let's see if we have a question here, and it comes from Pastor Alan Ray in South Georgia. Thanks for clearly illustrating that Scripture interprets Scripture. My question is, when did this really fall into misuse? Great question about this, because it's something that I think is touted but not used. You ask a pastor, how do you interpret the Bible? And he's probably heard, well, you let Scripture interpret Scripture. But evidence is clear that that's not what most pastors are doing. Rather, they are they're letting their own experience interpret Scripture. Probably that's the first, or their own feelings interpret Scripture. Or very, very often, and this is so true of both laymen and pastors, they're letting what they've always heard interpret Scripture. Now, I think when did it fall into misuse is kind of hard to say, but probably somewhere, again, with the church growth movement and the pragmatism that brought into the church. I listen from time to time to Dr. W.A. Criswell, who is deceased a number of years, but for nearly 50 years, he was pastor at the First Baptist Church of Dallas, Texas. And he was a dispensationalist in a day when, even in the Southern Baptist Convention, which has never been full of dispensationalists, but he was one. And he wrote a book called Why I Teach That the Bible is Literally True. And that book literally caused a revolution in the Southern Baptist Convention, believe it or not. But nonetheless, the point that I want to bring up is when I listen to his sermons, he brings up the Greek. He's very meticulous in history and doctrine. He uses big words. He's very scholarly in his approach, and yet a fire in his bones all at the same time. And yet, as I listen to that, I say there is no way that Dr. W.A. Criswell would be the pastor of a large, or the what was then the largest church in the Southern Baptist Convention. He simply would not be that today, because the church today, whether Southern Baptist or you pick your poison, whatever it is out there, is so hungry for psychology, application, love stories, a little bit of laughter, feel-good spirit as we go on, and throw in a few Bible verses. And so somewhere, and we're doing that, I think, because of church growth, this is what it takes. We've lost our ability to think or to care about intellectual matters or to know the things of the Word. And it's very sad that this has happened. So, you know, when did it happen? I don't know. It did happen, and the only thing that is left is people saying you should interpret Scripture by Scripture. They just don't do it. As you see, even in the New American Standard Bible and the reference that they turned that so positive when Scripture, I think, just doesn't allow it to be turned positive. And we've just got to get back to this. You know, related to this is, of course, what I say all the time, question the assumptions. And modern Christians just have a terrible time questioning the assumptions. Again, no one wants to think that this means me, but we have adopted some thinking that we are simply not willing to question. We're not willing to put it up there. Now, I know I say question the assumptions a lot, and from time to time, someone will come to me and say, well, don't take that too far. And I say, honestly, you can take that as far as you want. You can't get that too far. And they'll say something, well, you mean you ought to question the assumption that the Bible is literally true? I say, yes, question that assumption. And here's why. Because when you study that with a critical mind, you're going to find out that the Bible is literally true. You're going to find out that Jesus was born of a virgin, that he lived a sinless life, that he died, buried, rose again on the third day, rose again. 40 days later, he ascended into heaven. He's coming back bodily. You're going to find out all these things are true. So question all of it. Don't put the line, say, well, question all the way up to here, and then don't question anymore. Keep questioning. Dig into that. Be a skeptic. Be a critical thinker is what it is. Now, if you'll do that, you'll also begin to be a critical thinker, that is a skeptic, that is question the assumptions. When you open up the newspaper or you hear the news, whether CNN or Fox or the Randy White News Network or whatever it may be, you're going to question the assumptions. And what a good thing it'll be. I don't know how I got into that sermon from your question, Alan Ray, but I wish that we would search the Scriptures to see what is true. And for the most part, people don't even know how to search the Scriptures anymore. One of the things that I love, of course, and that I think is so valuable in my Scofield Reference Bible is, I think one of the best parts of it is the reference system right in the middle. And yet those have fallen into lack of use itself. And that is just a means of helping you, let Scripture interpret Scripture. So thanks for letting me get on a soapbox there and preach a little bit. Let's see. Got another question here from Josh. I think it's a question. Does Dispensational Publishing House ship to Canada? And I don't see your book on the Antichrist in the DPH store. Well, great two questions, Josh. And one is that we do ship to Canada, but the website won't show it. So what you have to do, those of you who are Canadians, is tell me what you want, and I'll send you let you know how much it would be for us to get it there. And it really does depend on what you order, how reasonably we can get it to you and whether or not it is valuable. Now, your point about my book on the Antichrist not being on the DPH store is because only recently have I even started carrying my book again, and I really want to go through and get all the non-King James stuff out of there and update it. I just haven't had the time to do it, so I don't market it that much, but it's available, and I'd be happy to get that out, and I probably should get it on the store as well. For a long time, I didn't even have any copies of it, honestly, and didn't have any to sell, but it is a good book. It's just that I would like to refine that some. That was about 6 years ago that I wrote that, I believe, maybe getting close to 7 now. And I've questioned some assumptions since that time. Thank you for those questions and those comments tonight. And as always, thank you for joining us in Bible study as we come together to visit. I hope you'll tell your friends to join us on these Thursday nights, whether they join live or not, whether they log in so we can see you, or they're just out there watching in Never Never Land of the Internet. We are always glad to have you from north, south, east, and west. I am Randy White, and it's been a blessing to spend this Thursday with you, and we'll be off next week for the Thanksgiving holiday and then pick back right back up where we started. Let me lead us in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for good people who join us tonight in Bible study. I pray you'd encourage them, bless them, and strengthen them tonight through these words. And we do pray for Israel, for the peace of Jerusalem. And our prayer with John is, come quickly, Lord Jesus. And our prayer with the apostles is, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless each one of you. Facebook.com/Randy White Ministries is our website, and we'll be very happy to see you on there. Until next time, I hope that you will rightly divide the word of truth. God bless you.